Okay, I'm going to talk for a moment about how to scale databases. Now, this is like databases themselves. This is a very broad topic, but there's a couple concepts I'd like to introduce because they're going to affect us in this class. There's two reasons you might need to scale a database. One is too much load, as in the database is just doing too much work. You know, you've got some website that is getting, you know, millions of requests a day or, you know, thousands of requests a second, and you've got this one machine that's got your data on it, and it just can't keep up with all of the work. So what you might do in this case is, you know, take your database, which are often represented as little cylinders, and replicate it to other databases. So every time we insert a piece of data to this database, we send it over to the other guys. So all of our database writes go into this one master database. In turn, all of that data gets replicated to these slave databases. So now we have three databases with all of our data on it, and so if you know, you've got a site like Reddit that's getting thousands and thousands of requests a second. Instead of sending all of the database reads, all of the lookups to this database, we can send it, you know, to these databases. And that alleviates a lot of this load off of this master database. Now, there are much more complicated schemes where you might, you know, have a multi-master system or a bunch of databases that all working together. But this is a fairly common setup and a fairly common approach to, you know, spreading around the reads, because generally in most systems you have a lot more reads than you do writes. So if your master can keep up with all of the writes, your slaves can handle all of the reads. There are some downsides to this. One is that it doesn't increase the speed of writes. You know, we're still bottlenecked by this one master receiving all of this data who has to, you know, in turn send it to all of these slaves. So if we can still fit all of our writes on this one machine, we're in good shape and we can spread the reads over, you know, as many machines as we need. You know, some of these slaves could even replicate to other machines. Another downside is this notion of replication lag. And this occurs when you write a piece of data to the master, but the read hits one of these slaves before the data has propagated. And that's called replication lag. And you can sometimes get some funny behavior. And the reason I bring it up now is because in the database we'll be using in this class, you can occasionally see symptoms of this type of behavior. It's not necessarily owing to a master-slave setup, but this is the general concept. Now, what happens if you have too much data for one machine? The replication handles the case where you have too much load. Basically, you've got to do, you know, too many reads so you can replicate your database to scale this out. What if you just have too much data? You know, your master database or any one of these databases can't even hold all of your data. You know, it doesn't fit in memory or even in disk. It's just, there's just too much. One of the things you can do is you can shard the database. And this is a fairly simple approach where instead of having one master, you might have a couple that are all the same size, despite my drawing. So let's say we're storing our links database. One approach to sharding might be to store links, you know, 1 through 100 here, actually more like 1 through a billion here, and 101 to 200 here, and, you know, 201 to 300 here. And basically, you store some of your links here, and some of your links here, and some of your links here in this database. Obviously, you know, 1 through 100 probably isn't the correct approach. You could probably use a hashing approach as if we had a hash table and these were all cells in our hash table and you know, hash on some particular key. In this case, I'm referring to link IDs, you know, the ID of whatever you're storing, to figure out which database you want to store it in. This is cool because now if we triple our write load from this scenario over here, we have three database machines to handle it. Likewise, we already have three machines to handle the read load. And of course, you can replicate these machines as well. And a lot of systems both shard and replicate your machines if you really want to get fancy. But there are some downsides to sharding as well. You know, one of the downsides is the queries get much more complex. You know, what if I said that this helps the case of find me the link whose ID is 150. You know, we just say, okay, which machine does 150 go to? And, you know, it hashes, you know, to this machine. And we do our read, and that's that. What if I said, get me all the links sorted by hotness, for example? Well, we don't know where that link may reside, especially if we're using a hashing algorithm that's, you know, more sophisticated than, you know, 1 through 100. That's called a range query. And a range query might have to hit all of your machines. And, you know, then we've lost our, you know, one of our advantages to using this. Now, you could replicate these to spread that around, but you have to hit all these machines and then merge the results probably and, you know, do the sort again in memory. And so, you know, some queries become very, very complex. Another downside is that joins become difficult or impossible. that makes sense. You know, so if we have this master database that has multiple tables on it, you know, we can do joins. But if we start sharding our database up, you know, we have one database that doesn't even fit on one machine. You know, so if we can't fit one database on our machine, how are we going to fit, you know, multiple databases? This notion that you have all of your tables in the same place to do a join, to do those fancy join SQL queries, becomes a lot more difficult. Now, there's a lot of research going on of building systems that can overcome these downsides. But if you take the naive approach to replicating and sharding, these are some of the things you'll have to deal with. Now, generally, the benefits outweigh the downsides, because if you design your data in such a way that you don't need to do joins or you don't need to do complex queries, you're in very good shape with both of these. Or maybe you have, you know, multiple setups, you know, one setup for handling your general load and another setup for handling your complex queries. You know, that's okay, and that's actually very common. Now, I wanted to introduce these concepts because the database we'll be using in this class, Google, the App Engine Data Store, actually has some of these limitations. There are no joins allowed, even though it does provide a SQL interface. And a lot of more complex queries that you could do in a general SQL database, you can't do in Google Data Store. But that's okay. You get this really nice benefit of having a database that is sharded and replicated to Wazoo and back. It's actually very fast and reliable. You know, you're probably not going to have to worry about systems crashing, something that, you know, replicating a database can help with and sharding a database can help with. Okay, so just wanted to introduce those concepts. Let's have a quick quiz on it before we move along. Which is an appropriate technique for increasing the read speed from a database? Get a faster machine, replicate the database, store less data, or press the turbo button?